So what we're going to
Yeah.
do is we're going to begin with a quick meditation real quick. This is something that I have learned from one of my writing class when I was in San Quentin State Prison. And one of a dear sister named Kathleen Jackson, she has shared that she went into to a retreat, and one of the retreat member has shared this with her. So it's kind of like a mindful practice of meditation, but with biblical scripture behind it.
Let Danny, let's let that get translated.
Gracias. Así, lo que compartió el compañero Dani T es que vamos a empezar esta sesión con un poco de meditación. Esto fue una práctica que aprendió de una compañera cuando estaba en San Quentin.
I guess before I begin, let's do the language, education access, just so that it'll be easier.
Sí, para hacer el proceso un poco más fácil, vamos a continuar con la práctica de justicia de lenguaje. Así que vamos a ir por las mejores prácticas.
So with that being, Danny, would you want to just tell everybody about the language access with the globe as I take it on?
Yes. And if you're a bit, if you're able to, you can put in the reminders on the slide. If not, I can just review it. But yes, everybody, as it is our norm, we will be providing interpretation for folks who speak Spanish to be able to participate and share the knowledge and participate as well. So for in English speakers, remember
Hold on,
in
can
a
you
few
share the slide?
moments,
Thanks.
We're going to turn on the interpretation feature. You will see at the bottom of your screen the globe. Selecting the globe will give you the prompt to switch between Spanish and English, as you can see on the screen. If you're using your phone,
Did we just lose Danny? We
yes.
lost him in the main room.
I think we lost him.
Yeah, go ahead again, Danny.
Okay. All right. In a little bit, we'll turn it back on. But as you can see, it does work. So yes, for English speakers, please look for either the globe or the three dots so you can turn this on. And now I'm going to say this in Spanish. Hola y muy buenas tardes a todos. Gracias por estar aquí. Como es usual, vamos a practicar nuestra justicia del lenguaje en este espacio para que todos podamos conversar en el idioma de nuestra preferencia o donde nos sientamos más cómodos. Así que vamos a aprender la función en un momentito. Y como anteriormente lo hemos hecho, van a buscar por la imagen del mundo que va a estar en la área inferior de su pantalla. Si está usando una tableta, un teléfono, tal vez va a tener que buscar los tres puntos, como está aquí la imagen a la mano derecha. Y ahí va a encontrar la sección para poder escuchar esta conversación en español. Así que otros recordatorios que quiero compartir con ustedes es recordar de poner su teléfono o la aplicación en mudo o en silencio cuando no está participando. Y si guste platicar y participar, puede levantar la mano o quitarse del modo mute o mute para que puedan participar. Y bueno, queremos que todos participen una persona a la vez. Y si tiene algún problema con el audio, puede dejarnos un mensaje en el chat. Nosotros vamos a monitorizar. Vamos a estar pendiente del chat, así que puede compartir con nosotros por medio del chat. And just a brief reminder for folks so that we can have this meeting the best as possible. If you are not participating, please put yourself on mute. And if you have any issues with the audio, please let us know via the chat. In a few moments, we're going to turn on the interpretation on, and then you'll be able to hear from me in the channel of your preference. And with that said, Danny T, you can turn on the interpretation.
Thank you, Danny. I'm turning on the interpretation right now. So for those who prefer English, click on English on the globe. And for those who prefer Spanish, click on Spanish on the globe. So with that being, just want to say thank you, everyone, and welcome again. Next slide. I'll go back.
Go back to the meditation. You're going to do the meditation.
The meditation. Yes, so let us come together collectively and practice some meditation practice just to clear out some of the everyday things that we have gone through to today, just so that we can help ground ourselves. So this practice was taught to me by a dear friend of mine named Sister Kathleen Jackson. She went to a retreat, and one of the retreat leader has shared this with her. It's basically a meditation form, but with biblical scripture behind it. So if you all can, get in a comfortable position in your chair or whatever posture that you are in. Let us start by just being comfortable where we're at, and allow your eyes to either gently close or gaze forward. And let us just begin by taking several long, slow, deep breaths, fully in. Then hold it, 2, 1, and exhale. Let us do one more. 3, 2, 1, and exhale. So allow your breath to find its own natural rhythm. Focus on your breathing. As you turn more in deeply inward, simply breathe, not striving to change anything about your breath. Just accept your experience and in the moment. Pay attention to your breathing as you inhale and exhale. As I speak portion of the sacred Hebrew scripture, focus on these words and let it heal you. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know that I am. Let not your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled. And do not be afraid. Do not let your heart be troubled. And do not be afraid. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. So as this practice comes to an end, let us slowly allow our attention to expand and notice your body. And then beyond your body, feel your surrounding. Give yourself a little stretch. And when you're ready, open up your eyes and slowly gaze either on the ground or in your surrounding. Just slowly bring yourself back into the present, into your awareness. And let us take one collective deep breath together. Ready? And hold it. 3, 2, 1, and let it out. Let's take one more deep breath. 3, 2, 1, and exhale. So gently let yourself come back. So thank you. Thank you for participating in our meditation. So with that being, let us go forward to our protocol. Next slide. Next slide. So this is our community accord. We normally go to this just to remind ourselves as a community that we will be able to show up for one another. So with the community accord, we want to remind ourselves to, first of all, center the experience of those who are most impacted. Let us step up and step back. This is a way for us to be able to share power in this space and also be aware that the power that we hold, whether it be our race, class, our faith, our gender, or so forth. Next, let us be conscious of any anti-Blackness or racism or any intersectional inequality. Next, let us practice curiosity. It is good to be curious. This is one of our learning, our way of learning, to ask questions, to be curious, and to be interesting. Next, let us deep listening with compassion. Listen with compassion. Next, let us allow people to make mistakes and say, ouch, and also keep asking questions. And lastly, let us respect each other. Just like that song, I think it's Aretha Franklin, R-E-S-P-E-C-T. That's what's going on through my mind. So thank you. Next slide, Hilda.
Ian, and with this slide, we would like to just remind that we are practicing just the fact that we're here, we're gathered today, we're practicing collective liberation. There are some of us who are joining, like me, from Riverside County, people from San Bernardino County, LA and Northern California. And so what a great way to practice this collective liberation. Thank you for joining us.
And for tonight, our summer series training will be on feminism and gender equity. So with our training, we would like to go deeper as leaders and to be able to share our analysis and share practices across our organization. And this right here would also allow us to know some principle or practices of feminism, gender equity that we may incorporate to help guide us. Next slide. And also keep in mind that Interfaith, we are an abolitionist organization, as we say, and these are some of the works that we are currently doing to ending ICE detention, closing prisons, preventing harm of ICE transfer, holding vigil that denounce the harms, and uplifting humanity and voices of those directly impacted. Community accompaniment as an alternative to detention, and also cutting funding to ICE and policing by investing in community care. Next slide. So with that being, we would like to welcome our guest, Margo. Margo will be teaching us about what feminism and gender equity is tonight. So with that being, let us give Margo an applause. And also, Margo, feel free to introduce yourself as well. Thank you.
I'll say a few words. I just want to thank, we have a special guest tonight, and Margo is a deep friend of Interfaith Movement for Human Integrity, cheerleading us on in our work for many years now. And Margo also has had a lot of experience as a woman of color, Black and Asian woman, and an immigrant woman also, in bringing all this together to think about feminism. The article that we sent out, I know it was kind of long and maybe a little bit complex. So we have time, you have time to read it later if you didn't get a chance, but Margo was part of writing that statement in the 1970s, which was trying to articulate a more complex understanding of feminism from an international and women of color perspective. So she told me to just keep it to one sentence. There's much more we could say, but we're just really lucky to have her be with us tonight.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for inviting me to be with you all today. I've been looking forward to this. So, and thanks to all the people who have made this possible for me to be with you all. We're one slide ahead. Can you go back one more? Yeah, there. Okay. So, you know, the way I like to have this conversation is for you all to really think about, in my case, in this case, feminism, feminists, how you all are thinking about it, if at all, your reactions. So really starting with what you already think and know, and then we'll move toward, at least by the end, some collective principles for you all as an organization. So that's the idea. So we'll start with what I talk about as the F word. You know, it's kind of play on that other F word. But anyway, please think about this question. When I hear the words feminism and feminist, I think, feel, imagine, say, dot, dot, dot. So if you want to just write in the chat, or if you want to unmute yourself and your quick reaction, you don't have to think deeply about it. These are just your reactions when you hear feminism and feminist. Anybody, please jump in. Whiteness. safe and affirmed. Gender equity, great. Think of strong woman, yay. Yeah. Empowerment, female unity. What else? Well, I guess this is the feminism and feminist isn't necessarily an F word anymore. So, you know, I'm really happy to read some of your reactions. Ordinary women in leadership. Do you all have any like bad opinions or bad impressions? You know, if you were in your community sitting with your family and you said, I'm a feminist, what kind of reaction might you get? Yes, and this is also what I'm trying to get to, that feminism was used against us in my time when I became a feminist in the 70s. To be called a feminist was a very bad word, right? And it was a time when we as a movement were trying to gain power and recognition and all of that. So it was used against us. And it was also equated with man-hating and being a lesbian, you know, all those two bad things that we were not supposed to be involved in, especially, yeah. So I also wanted to acknowledge those views about feminism as well. And think about, again, if you went back to your communities, your families, and declared that you're a feminist, whether you're a man, woman, whatever your gender is, what would be your what would be their reaction? And I want you to think about that as well, right? Because like with much of the work you do, you're pushing up against, you know, people's beliefs, stereotypes, and ways that a good effort is made to be something dirty or not useful, right? Think about when you push up against prison authorities or the carceral state, we're often told that that's really the wrong direction. And that's what feminists were told, you know, early on. Even when the suffragists were talking about getting their votes. So,
Margaret, can we make some room for the Spanish speakers in case anybody wants to say anything in Spanish?
Yeah, thank you. Yep. Yeah, sorry, I was just paying attention to the chat.
So would anyone like to say anything in Spanish? You can.
I'm not hearing anything, so.
I would like to say something, if that's okay.
Okay.
This, please, yeah. The question took me to a time when I was in a circle of women of faith, had a Catholic conference, and I chimed in and I was told I couldn't be a feminist because I was married and had several children. And so I was therefore excluded right away from this conversation that was taking place. And so today I want to like reaffirm that, like, yeah, I'm a feminist. I am a wife. I am a mother of nine, and I am a woman of faith. I'm a feminist.
Right, thank you. That's a really important example. Jose?
Yeah, just want to ask a question like, would I mean, are men allowed to be, or were they be able to be a part of the feminism movement, or would they be like, could they be like part, not a participant, but like members of the feminism movement?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. Okay. Yeah, so yeah, go ahead.
Because I was just thinking feminism would be like just a, like, I thought it would be just a all woman membership, right? But now that I get an idea that, you know, men could be included as well, that's part of, thank you.
Yeah, I think feminism movement is very similar to racial justice movement, right? Sometimes there will be spaces when it will be all people of one gender, right? And then other times it'll be mixed. Just like when we do racial justice work, we have these breakout rooms sometimes, right? People of color groups or specific racial groups, and then we all come together. So it's a very similar principle to that. And in fact, like all other justice movements, we need everybody's hands in the work. So thank you for raising that question. Really important.
No, thank you. Thank you for your response. Appreciate you.
Any other questions? So including women with equal rights as men. And as Jose says, you've been an aspiring feminist for many years. Yay, we like to hear that. Other comments? Okay, let's move on. So as we go from one topic
puedo,
to the next.
¿Puedo hablar yo, por favor?
Please, yes.
Okay, please. En español, okay? Para mí la palabra feminismo, obviamente, es cuando nosotras las mujeres tenemos los mismos derechos que el caballero, ¿cierto? Las mismas oportunidades. Para mí es eso el feminismo, ser equitativo. Pero también, en mi opinión, a veces eso se sale fuera de control, porque hay obviamente ciertas damas que abusan de ese término. ¿A qué me refiero que abusan? Porque también tienen ese poder de pisotear, de quitarle la dignidad pues al hombre. Entonces estamos hablando de equidad, que 50, ¿verdad? 50% la mujer y el 50% el hombre. O definitivamente en términos generales, 50% la pareja, ambas parejas. Para mí eso es, tiene ese significado. Gracias.
Gracias, thank you. And I think this idea of women abusing power is, you know, something that I hope we'll get to talk about afterwards, later. I think that's really important what you're saying. Are there any other comments from anyone?
I think there's a couple hands raised.
Okay, I can't see the hands, so. Can you just call on the hand you see raised?
No, I can't see it. Maybe they put the hands down.
Elizabeth Medina.
Sí, no sé si me escuchan. Sí. Bueno, en lo personal, cuando yo escucho hablar sobre el término feminismo, se me viene a la mente la capacidad que existe entre el hombre y la mujer de poder llegar a ser seres iguales. Pero lamentablemente, en la realidad, en el hoy de la historia, nos damos cuenta de que hay mucha brecha en este campo. Mucho por trabajar, mucho por fomentar. Aunque se han ganado muchas batallas o algunas, digamos, todavía seguimos con este problema en donde el machismo, el androcentrismo, está infiltrado en la sociedad, en las venas de la sociedad. Por eso continuamente vemos noticias de personas que, mujeres, jóvenes, adultas que han sido asesinadas, o violencia de género, etcétera, ¿verdad? Esa es una cosa, pero tampoco vamos a decir que en algunos casos algunas mujeres son machistas también. Entonces creo de que realmente el término feminista apunta a esta equidad y a ese sueño de que ambos sexos estemos en el mismo nivel, ni uno arriba ni uno abajo, pero para eso creo que hay mucho camino por recorrer.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Sí.
Others, this is a great start, because what I hear is, you know, very complex reaction that you have to the idea, to what you've observed in your lives, perhaps in your family, you know, like this. So this is rich. This is a very good starting place. Are there any other reactions, comments, what you've observed?
I would like to add that just hearing what Elizabeth said, you know, reminded me that feminism is a response to violence and violence that happens in society and, you know, violence that happens in the carceral systems where, you know, the expression and the oppression of gender is heightened and even stronger, but in all aspects of our society. So I appreciated just remembering this context of violence and where feminism comes into it, because we've been talking about how are we trying to prevent harm and be against all harm in society.
Pedro.
Yeah, so for me, I mean, I'm sorry, I lost signal for like a couple of minutes, maybe a few, but I was trying to come back. So I kind of missed a few of the comments, but one thing that I had put in the chat right before I was kicked out for a few minutes was like, when it comes down to feminism, right? Equality for women, equal rights, just as men. And what comes to my mind for me, as someone that follows sports, I'm a big soccer fanatic. I think they have the women, the U.S. national soccer team, I know that they've been trying to have the equal pay. And I have to put it like this in perspective. The women's national soccer team has been tremendously successful, meaning winning World Cups, accomplishing more for us as sports fans, for the United States as a whole, than the men's soccer team, right? And here we are where still our male athletes are known to get maybe twice as much, right, than women's athletes. And quite frankly, when I think about that, it's so much, that's what comes to my mind. You know, I'm still learning and I'm still kind of growing in all this education. But when I hear about feminism and how, you know, I believe that everybody should have the equal pay, the equal rights. And that's where I think I've heard, I think it was Hilda that was talking about like those, you know, era. I mean, some of us too, we have that throughout history, like the machismo that comes with our culture, our backgrounds, our cult, ethnicity, everything like that. I mean, it could still show and manifest on women too. No doubt, no denying that. But when I think about the term, I'm thinking of just the equality, having equal rights. And in this case, I'm thinking of equal pay, right? For both, you know, genders, male and females, and everybody equally. Thank you.
Thank you. And Karen wrote in the chat that, how can you all deal with the deeply divisive definition of feminism that have broken apart past ways that people were together as allies? and coming up with an expanded definition. And that's the point of this workshop, is that you all collectively would come up with a definition that, you know, really resonates with your values, the mission of your organization, and so forth. Right. So thank you, Karen, for raising that idea of the expanded definition. Okay, this is Rich. Thank you so much. And, you know, I heard consistently comments about equity, which is different from equality. Equity means that people are brought into a situation according to their abilities, you know, their histories in such a way that they can be full participants. So if I, using the soccer metaphor, well, I don't know if I can use the soccer metaphor, but if I started already, let's say we're trying to walk or run or get from point A to point B, and somebody already starts in the middle, right? Somebody else starts at A, somebody else starts between A and B, then treating everybody the same would not get us to a fair space. So let's think about equity as the concept, as the title of this workshop suggested.
Should we go to the next slide?
Thank you. Yes, please. And thank you, Allison, for your comment about the beautiful idea. Okay, so, you know, one of the things I'm supposed to do today is sort of talk about kind of the ways that I think about feminism and some of the key definitions, and I will get to that in a little while. But I'd like you all to really talk among yourselves, and we'll do this in small groups, right? And you already started this from the first slide, but for the next 10 minutes, I would say, if you could get into the small groups and go deeper into some of your own thinking about what you already know and understand, and also, equally important is what questions you have. You know, like that question before, can men be feminists or join the feminist movement? So if you would get into the small groups and talk about these questions, what do you already know and understand? What questions and what questions do you have? So can whoever's in charge? Yeah.
I'm gonna assign.
So. And I'd like you all to just come back with your main ideas about what you know and one or two questions, please.
Have you got it, or you want me to create it?
I'm doing it. Maybe you could put the questions in the chat. That would be great. Okay, I'll just take a second. I'm just assigning here.
And for those who are Spanish speaking, you don't have to choose the group, just stay here in the main room.
Margo, what are you going to do?
Can we check in, or do you all want to go into your small groups? Because I can sit here and just think about what's already been said.
Okay, why don't you sit in the main room?
All right. Yeah.
I'm sending you all to your groups. Let's, Hilda, can you not take the screen share off a second? Let's see. Okay. Are people in the groups? Let's see. Did it work? It did. What? Do you have to hit join? Okay, so. Let's see. Danny, are you, do you see you're being asked to join one too?
No.
No? Okay, I'll move you. Okay. Sige, Hilda.
Who's this here? You remember me, Jose Ruben?
Yeah, I sure do. I do remember. It's so good to see y'all again, you know.
Hilda, you're with us.
Yes, I'm usually sent. She sent me here.
I have a feeling.
And it's my boss. How do I say no to that?
Well, let's do something great then.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So, wait, does everyone know Hilda? Does Hilda know everyone?
I don't know, Hilda. Do you know?
Got it. Yeah, I was going to say.
I'm Karen Alschuler, and I'm the co-chair of the NEET of the Combined Sheareth Israel Jewish Congregation with St. Mary's Episcopal.
Nice to meet you,
Karen. We're inseparable. Never shall we be divided. It's just a wonderful group of people.
Fantastic. Great. And now Maisha's here. Hey, Maisha. Are you there, Maisha?
Maisha
is one of our part-time staff in LA with Reverend Larry Foy. All right. Well, your audio isn't working well. Okay, can you hear us okay, Maisha? You'll just be listening in and using the chat. Okay, you're working on. Okay. Well, why don't we get started, and maybe as people
movimiento. Ay, perdón. ¿Sí me escuchan?
Sí, te estamos escuchando bien.
¿Es este un movimiento específicamente concerniente a los derechos de nosotras las mujeres, a nuestra dignidad, y que nos gustaría atender a la misma igualdad, ya sea económica, social, política? Eso es lo que yo entiendo. Pero obviamente yo sé que soy nueva en este tema, pero también hay veces lo que yo observo, ¿verdad? Con todo respeto que ustedes me merecen, que esto, yo sé que no puedo generalizar que haya bastantes personas que hacemos juicios acerca de este tema, ¿verdad? Pero lo que yo he visto personalmente, porque trabajo en la comunidad y me doy cuenta de ciertos comentarios, y con caballeros, con mujeres, y mayormente ahorita a veces que hay como un sobrepoder acerca, no sé si me vaya a ayudar a explicar, hay veces que las mujeres de tanto empoderamiento acerca de este movimiento, ¿verdad? Porque yo completamente como mujer sé que estoy al mismo nivel que todos, pero en el hogar he aprendido que mi esposo me da esa igualdad como mujer, ¿verdad? Entonces, así mismo estoy formando a mis dos hijas adolescentes, pero sin que eso sobrepase, si sé que sobrepase esa línea de empoderamiento a nosotras las mujeres. ¿Qué quiero decir con esto? Como les vuelvo a repetir, hay veces que nosotros en esos temas empoderamos tanto, tanto a las mujeres, a nosotras mismas, que como que brincamos rebasamos esa línea. ¿Cuál línea? Pues hay veces que también hacemos despojos a los caballeros. Y obviamente eso no, yo en lo personal no estoy de acuerdo. Estamos hablando de equidad, estamos hablando de humanizar, de concientizar. Entonces, partes iguales. O sea, quiero que yo que tú me trates con el mismo respeto, pero yo también te voy a tratar con el mismo respeto, ¿cierto? Entonces, una igualdad para que también nuestras mujercitas no se sobrepasen de este movimiento, porque obviamente tengo dos hijos, y a mí no me gustaría que se sobrepasaran, y viceversa. A mí no me gustaría que tener mis hijas que se sobrepasaran con esos límites con sus respectivas parejas. Me gustaría la igualdad, la equidad. Gracias. Yo sé que estoy aprendiendo en este tema, me falta mucho, pero a lo mejor yo sé que acá hay bastante personas que tienen más conocimiento, son más profesionales. Entonces, si cometo algún error, discúlpenme, estoy aprendiendo, ¿ok? Gracias.
Muchas gracias, María Elena, por tu participación. Yo quisiera hacer un comentario cuando la ponente preguntaba qué es el feminismo, y yo recuerdo empezar a escuchar este término o interesarme hace más de 10 años. Y para mí era muy difícil dentro de un contexto de iglesia, porque no entendía, no sabía, y pensaba que el feminismo intentaba superiorizar a la mujer comparado con el hombre. Y recuerdo que leí una autora mexicana, una antropóloga, que dice, ser feminista es no aceptar que la diferencia sexual se traduzca en desigualdad social. Y quizá esta definición fue de hace más de 20 años, y ahora lo diría, que la diferencia de género no sea una diferencia social. Y estudiando más el tema a fondo, entendemos o sabemos que las personas más pobres en el mundo son mujeres. Y los hombres en posiciones más altas, en una compañía, incluso gobernando los países, son hombres, ¿no? Entonces, yo quisiera invitarles a que saliéramos un poco del contexto de nuestros hogares, ¿no? Yo sé que todos estamos luchando para que haya equidad en nuestros hogares, pero pensemos un poco más allá, porque el movimiento feminista empezó hace varias décadas y no termina. ¿Qué nos hace falta? Yo siempre digo gracias a las mujeres feministas de hace 30, 40 años que lucharon para que las mujeres pudiéramos acceder a la educación universitaria. Gracias a ellas yo pude estudiar una carrera. Gracias a las mujeres que hace 70 años lucharon para que las mujeres pudiéramos votar, ¿no? Ahora, ¿qué tenemos que hacer en este tiempo? Y no solamente como mujeres, sino mujeres y hombres, para que las siguientes generaciones digan gracias a quienes vivieron en el siglo XX, en el 2000, 2010, ¿qué nos tienen que agradecer? Les quiero dejar con esa pregunta, con esa reflexión más bien.
Y a mí me gustaría continuar un poquito dentro de lo que acabas de, esas palabras sabias, ¿no? Porque ¿qué nos hace falta? Nos hace falta ese compromiso. Primero que todo, educarnos. ¿Qué es el feminismo? A mí hace aproximadamente unos 16 años, cuando me sucedió esto, ¿no? Con un grupo de mujeres en una conferencia católica, donde se me hizo creer que yo no podía ser feminista, ni me podían incluir en la conversación porque yo estaba casada y tenía hijos. Y eso me excluía. Y creo que esa es la mentalidad primero que tenemos que quitar, ¿no? Que dentro de este movimiento necesitamos de todos. Y si alguien no está completamente ahí, ¿cómo me la traigo? ¿Qué hacemos para que la persona se eduque en lo que verdaderamente es el feminismo y lo practique? Y lo practiquemos. Gracias a Dios. Después he estado con grupos donde también los hombres ya se consideran feministas. Y creo que eso nos va ayudando, ¿no? Nos va ayudando y nos damos más a conocernos unos a otros. Pero creo que sí, nos hace falta mucha educación para poder responder. Sí. En aquel entonces yo no pude responderle. Y me quedé tan herida que me fue más fácil retirarme. Entonces, ¿cómo estoy pensando yo? ¿Qué hubiera necesitado? ¿Cuáles son las palabras? ¿Qué es lo que necesitamos saber para poder decir, oh, no, discúlpame, pero no es esto? O lo que estás haciendo no tiene nada que ver con el feminismo. Son ciertas cosas así, creo yo. ¿Qué piensan ustedes?
Totalmente de acuerdo, señora Hilda. Nos falta mucha, mucha educación.
Pero por eso estamos aquí.
Sí, aprendiendo. Gracias, Nadia. Gracias.
No sé si alguien más tiene algún comentario.
Hola. Pues me quedo bien sorprendida. Honestamente, no tenía idea cómo que era ese la feminismo. Entonces, yo compartí con muchas personas ahora que estuve en la detención, personas adolescentes más que nada, que venían huyendo de sus países, ¿verdad? Por motivo de su género, de su género, y unas entraban golpeadas porque las golpeaban, querían asustadas, querían matarlas, y todo eso se me hizo muy triste. ¿Por qué no generalizamos, ¿verdad? Por igualdad, no sé cómo explicar lo que viví con estando ahí con feminismo, pero quiero aprender, y como dices tú, compañera Nadia, estamos aquí para saber y comprender, ¿verdad? Comprender. Y pues discúlpeme, como le digo, no me sé explicar, primera vez que escucho eso, y he escuchado todos los comentarios, y creo que poquito voy abriendo mi mente. Muy buena reflexión que nos dejaste, Nadia. Es para pensarle y sacar algo positivo de ahí.
No tienes nada de qué disculparte, Floricel. Tu explicación es muy clara. Gracias.
Gracias.
Yo quisiera retomar algo que dijo Hilda sobre los hombres feministas, ¿no? No podríamos tener un movimiento con tanto éxito si uh-huh. los que están, lo voy a decir, en el poder, en muchos ámbitos, no se aliaran con nosotras. Entonces, hay que reconocer el apoyo de algunos hombres, ojalá que fueran todos, el mundo cambiaría, uh-huh, para sí. que haya esta equidad de género.
Luego también me gustaría hablar de algo cuando no es un feminismo real. Y yo cuando hablo de no es un feminismo real, en mi mente luego se viene la ex senadora Hillary Clinton, que corrió para ser presidenta. Y ella para mí, ella quería que la percibiéramos como una mujer empoderada del feminismo, pero sin embargo tenía y caminaba y se desarrollaba en un mundo de varones con un poder masculino, donde la realidad, yo nunca pude verle ese lado feminista a ella. Entonces, para mí ese era no era real, no era un feminismo real. Margo dice que hay que prepararnos para regresar a la sala principal. Ah, pensaba sí. que estábamos en la sala principal, con eso de que me rebotaron.
Esta es la sala principal, entonces.
Okay. Sí, entonces aquí me quedo.
Sí.
Ok. Pues gracias a todos. Gracias, Nadia.
Gracias, Nadia.
Gracias a todas y todos.
Gracias, gracias, Nadia.
Aprendemos.
Gracias.
Sí, aprendemos más.
Welcome. Welcome back, everyone.
Welcome back, everybody. So if you can, I think you have to go back to the globe and hit the language access that you prefer.
And please let me know, Margo, if you want me to share my screen so that we can see the presentation.
Yes, but for now, what happened in the small group? Main question, main idea that came out of the small group? Maybe each group can just say one thing.
I nominate Jose Aristiliana from our group.
Sure. I was just about to type it in the chat. But the one thing is that I think we all acknowledged that there was a fair understanding, at least, of what feminism, if feminism is about, is the stuff you already covered, Margo. That we all share that. I think a couple of interesting points came out from, well, before Deborah joined us, we were kind of worried that, oh, he's all guys, but we got over that quickly. The main things was that we recognize that feminism is a long-standing movement, and that as it's evolved, as it's matured, it's gone through several stages and several moments of tension. Larry specifically called out the tension between the mid-60s, I guess it was a second wave or whatever they called that wave, which was mostly led by white women, white feminists, and then this evolution that was led more by Black feminists, and how basically it's a tension, but I don't think it's a split by any means, but it's something that's going on that I think we should recognize. And
that's your one thing.
One more.
That's your one thing.
What's that?
That's our one thing.
That's the one thing, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Next group, and group two, let's say.
Nominate Allison to pose her last question.
About feminism being non-masculine. So we raised several questions, but one of the questions is while feminism kind of has the idea of women, it also in recent times issues like trans rights and gender non-binary people often fall into the category of we go into feminism to discuss these issues because there's masculine and feminine, and anything that's non-masculine must fit in the feminine group. And that just raised a question of, and to what extent is feminism perpetuating a binary understanding of gender in addition to all the positive things? You know, how do we talk about feminism and not want to engage in these gender binaries, particularly when they've been hierarchical and so devastating.
Okay. Thank you. Another group. There were quite a few small groups, so.
There's one last English group. Caroline, are you speaking?
I was wondering if Susanna or Anne would like to speak.
I think Anne.
Okay.
Well, I have issues with short-term memory, so I'll do the best I can. Let's see. We had a nice male person in our group who was really had very good questions about what is feminism and can he be a feminist. And of course, you can be a feminist. We talked about feminism as something where men and women, and I guess, you know, people who identify themselves in other ways share power. So it's the idea of dominance or the idea of dominating other people kind of is kind of put by the wayside, and it really does become a way to share power and to cooperate and to because it's important for men to have what we traditionally call feminine traits, such as softness and compassion. And then it's important for women to be able to assert power and be comfortable doing it. So that's about as much as I can remember. Thank you.
Other groups?
The group in the main room in Espanol.
I think there's a chat from that room.
Maybe Danny, do you want to say yours out loud? And then we can have it interpreted. Oh, he can't. He can't because he's an interpreter.
Oh, he's an interpreter.
Okay. Can someone read it out loud? Then they can interpret. Let me see. Okay.
It's an Dani says, thank you all so much for participating. Thank you to all the feminists. Me as a man, I have more liberty. But thank you to all of ellas, meaning the women, I can express my my feelings without feeling shame. And today, I have the intelligence and capacity, emotional capacity, to collaborate with people that are of different genders in groups, in different groups, and where I feel safe. So this is what he said. And so he's very grateful to all of us feminists in this group.
Thank you for that. Other.
Otro comentario del grupo en español. No, grupo de Nadia.
Bueno, solamente María Elena quiere decir que le hace falta mucha, pero mucha educación, porque esta es mi primera vez aprendiendo con este grupo maravilloso. Y sí, definitivamente estoy de acuerdo con el caballero que acaba de poner en el chat, que tanto los hombres ya están teniendo esa capacidad de inteligencia acerca de no tener el estigma de tener pena por hablar, incluso me atrevo a decir por llorar, porque a veces decimos, es de que los hombres no lloran, ¿verdad? Pero no, tenemos que tener esa capacidad, esa inteligencia de ser abiertos emocionalmente, físicamente y obviamente espiritualmente. Entonces, acerca de este tema, voy a aprender de que tengo que tener la capacidad de incluir a todo género. Eso es algo nuevo para mí, pues muchísimas gracias por educarme. Gracias.
Like Elizabeth has a hand raised.
Sí. Bueno, en el contexto de todo lo que estamos diciendo ahora, se me venía una frase a la mente que fue escrita por Eduardo Galeano. Él es de Uruguay, fue escritor y periodista. Y me remontaba años atrás, en la época en que fue escrita la Biblia incluso, y nos damos cuenta de que hasta la misma Biblia fue escrita por hombres. Todo eso tiene que ver con el patriarcado que hemos venido respirando las generaciones antiguas, posteriores y actualmente. Y la frase a mí me encanta. Dice así, si Eva hubiera escrito el Génesis, ¿cómo sería la primera noche de amor del género humano? Eva hubiera empezado por aclarar que ella no nació de ninguna costilla, ni conoció a ninguna serpiente, ni ofreció manzanas a nadie, y que Dios nunca le dijo que parirás con dolor y tu marido te dominará, que todas esas son puras mentiras que Adán contó a la prensa. La verdad que yo algún par de veces la publiqué en mis redes, ¿verdad? Y algunas personas me tacharon de que yo soy una persona atea, porque como yo estudié teología, ¿verdad? Entonces me han dicho que yo soy atea, que esto y que lo otro. Pero realmente, bueno, las cosas no son así. Esa frase dice mucho, 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 ¿verdad? De este escritor. Y lamentablemente pues, hay muchísima tela por cortar, porque yo puedo decir yo soy feminista, fulana es feminista y fulano es feminista, pero en la praxis de la vida realmente yo me pregunto, ¿realmente soy feminista? ¿Cómo yo veo a mis compañeras, a mis compañeros? ¿Ah? Porque de boca yo puedo decir tanto, pero mis actitudes realmente demuestran y dicen quién soy yo. Entonces, igual, yo me sigo sintiendo retada y desafiada por todo lo que hay, porque la Biblia fue escrita por hombres, porque a la mujer se le reconoce poco y porque el machismo y el androcentrismo siguen bailando hoy en día. Gracias.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Okay, any other comments?
De nada.
We're quickly running out of time, I think.
Why don't we go to the concepts slide?
Yeah. Okay. So but I just want to say something from what you've reported, which is really important, that feminism is the long-standing movement. And it's really also very important to remember that this idea that we have that the feminist movement was primarily white women or was a white women's movement, that's a media representation that doesn't really tell the full story of the feminist movement. So that's another session that we need to have. There have always been women of color and women all over the world who have been part of the women's movement from very early on. So that's very important. The second thing that I think is important that came out of what you all said is that the oppression of women also has an impact on the socialization and the way that men are raised. So for example, somebody made the comment that men aren't supposed to cry, right? That's because men's strength means that you don't cry, you don't show emotion. And the other side of it is, of course, is that women are always emotional. So, you know, the oppression of women and oppression of, and the way that men are socialized go together. And that's really important. And we'll come into that a little bit later.
Can go to the
slide. Should we go to the next slide? Mm-hmm. So the first important concept is patriarchy. And, you know, when we talk about feminism, or we talk about women's rights, we think about it more as individual, you know, who has rights, who doesn't. And I think a really important basic concept about feminism is that the oppression of women is rooted in a whole social system and institutions that are organized with men as the dominant group and women as the subordinated group. And there was the comment earlier about who wrote the Bible. And that's sort of and not just the Christian Bible, but the texts of the holy texts of all the monotheistic religions were written, presented by men. And of course, it has the interest of men deeply embedded in it. So that example really fits this idea of patriarchy. So what's important is that as a system, right, it's really important to look at not just how individual men behave, right, and how women are expected to behave, but that it's a whole system, institutions like schools, family, court system are all set up in a particular way that benefits, in this case, men. And if you have questions, please, you know, write them in the chat, either in English or Spanish, and we'll come back to it. Next slide, please. So patriarchy is the foundation kind of value, right? Then related to that, of course, is this idea of gender. And somebody mentioned earlier, we've been socialized and to think that there are two genders only. And lately, we've seen that there's been a real push for all of us, not just the feminist movement, but all of us in the society to consider that there may be more than two genders. And the kind of the traditional or conventional way of thinking about gender is based on the side, this assumed to be biological difference, right, between men and women. And out of those differences are generated specific norms, that is what's normal for men and women, what's the behaviors expected for men and women, even colors like boys blue, girls pink. And sometimes I invite you to go to Target or one of your favorite shops like that, and go to the girls' clothing section and the boys' clothing section, and just look at the colors of the clothing. And that's an example. Another important part of the gender is that the traditional gender roles are advanced or are promoted as the truth, not to be questioned, because the Bible says so, or because this law says that. This is a really important idea to challenge, right? What is true about gender? Again, I invite you to write your questions in the chat and reactions. Okay, next slide, please. So this concept of intersectionality is really important. I noticed you use it in your the way you present yourselves as an organization. It's a word that gets used quite a bit in activist circles, even in public policy circles these days. So from my perspective, and it often gets reduced as multiple identities. You know, I'm this race, I'm that gender, I'm this class, like all the social categories are added together and it forms somebody's identities. So what I want to clarify here from my point of view and my understanding and thinking about it is that intersectionality pushes us to think that it's not just one thing, right? It's not just gender or race or class or sexual orientation, right? But that, in fact, all these exist at the same time and they're linked together. And that the ways they're linked gives us an idea that in one category we may be oppressed, right? And in another category, we may have more power. Right? So the context, that is where an action is taking place or wherever you are determines which category is the most important. So I'll just take myself as an example. I'm a middle-class woman with lots of education, you know, so if I'm, and I'm a professor, I was a professor in the classroom, you know, I can have lots of power. But when I step outside the classroom and I'm just walking on campus, if people didn't know me, they might say, oh, she's just a, you know, a woman of color. Maybe she's, you know, one of the cleaners or, you know, something like this based on stereotypes, right? So the context really shapes which category becomes the most important category in that setting. Next slide, please. And just one other thing about, so this is good. So intersectionality is also a way to understand power. Many times we think if you're this one category, then you're powerful. If you're in that same category, you don't have any power. So let's take race, for example. If you are a white person, then you have power. It doesn't matter if you're a poor white person or if you're a man or a woman or a trans person, right? So we make these simple ideas about power, who is powerful, who isn't. And which brings me to the next point, which is a feminist understanding of power relates to the original slide about patriarchy, right? That power plays out interpersonally, it plays out in institutions and in organizations, and it's built into the way the society is organized, right? And power, which basically means the ability of individuals, groups of people, institutions, and structures to direct or influence the behavior of others or the course of events, right? So, for example, within the family, let's say it's a traditional, conventional family with the man as the head of household. Let's say the woman works inside the household. I'm talking very conventionally, right? But let's say it's an immigrant family. Let's say it's a non-documented immigrant family. It doesn't matter in some ways the what happens within the family, what matters. Think about what happens when the mother and the father both step out of the family, out of the house, right? And how they're treated and what happens to the power that say the father had within the family. But once he steps out as an undocumented person, the kind of power he has, even as a man. And then the last point is that for me, my understanding of feminism is that transformation, creating changes from the roots of the problem is a really important vision of feminism. So the roots of racism, roots of gender oppression, classism, anti-immigration policies, incarceration policies. Those are the ways that the bad things come out. For us feminists, we see how all those are connected and we try to get to the roots of them and create a society where none of those would exist, and that when we've transformed the society from feminist perspective, looked at intersectionally, that all the groups who have been oppressed, right, would be liberated, because a feminist vision of transformation is changing the structures and the institutions, right, in such a way that everybody, including the planet, thrives. And that's the feminist vision of transformation. So let me just stop here and take questions. And we can start with the first concept, or you can start anywhere with your question. So the key concepts are patriarchy, gender, power, intersectionality, and transformation. Did I make everybody fall asleep?
No.
There was a lot. Okay, there was a lot. So please ask your questions. And then we're going to get to practice of feminism next. But these are basic concepts, and they're very shortened. So if you have questions about any of the concepts or reactions even to the definitions, please speak up or write it in the chat.
Yo quiero compartir algo que mencionaron acerca de, me llamó mucho la atención cuando mencionaron que niña color rosa y hombre azul, ¿verdad? Casualmente, tengo tres adolescentes que nacieron aquí en los Estados Unidos y pues como niños, ¿verdad? Jugaban con ciertas cosas. Mi esposo y yo les compramos juguetes, pero María Elena y su esposo se dieron cuenta que a mis dos niñas específicamente nunca les atrayeron las muñecas. Entonces, amigos, miraban ese comportamiento y obviamente con juicios, ¿verdad? Con juicios. Y María Elena dice que eso no es normal. Son niñas. Se supone que tienen que jugar con muñecas, no con carros. Entonces, como María Elena, honestamente soy abierta a cualquier cosa. Digo, son niños, son niñas, o whatever. Tienen que explorar diferentes cosas y punto. No les voy a decir, es de que vas a jugar a fuerza, o sea, dominarlos a que van a jugar con las muñecas, si no les aten las muñecas. Eran felices con los carros. Entonces yo nunca les prohibí esa parte o volví a lo mismo del poder y el control, que siguieran jugando felizmente con sus carritos. Posteriormente fueron creciendo. Y la niña más grande empezó a usar pantalones. Entonces, en mi cultura hay una palabra que es bastante fuerte e incómoda para mí, en lo personal, imagínense, soy latina. Y a las mujeres cuando empiezan a usar pantalones, les dicen marimachas. Hey, ¿es usted una mujer y tiene que vestir falda o vestido? Entonces, a mi esposo, obviamente, defendiendo a su hija, no, si ella se siente cómoda con pantalones, es su cuerpo y yo tengo que respetar su manera de pensar y de sentir. Le gustan los pantalones.
Okay.
Gracias.
Thank you. Yes. María Elena, you raised a really very good example of the relationship between the culture that says one thing, you know, girls, you have to play with dolls, boys, you have to do this, etc. And sometimes the ways that individual families can make different choices for their own children. But at the same time, they're still pressured by the outside. So that example you gave is a really good one. And that's the relationship between culture and individual practices. And sometimes the culture wins because it has more power once the child steps outside of the home.
Margot, I want to, I think we're going to go a little bit longer if that's okay with others. Maybe for your section, Margot, till 8:15, and then we have 5 minutes of important upcoming announcements.
So okay.
Okay. If that's okay. It's so very, everyone's very interested. If you can stay, please stay. If you have to leave, it's okay. We are recording.
And also, I'd like to invite when you speak to make sure that there may be other people who might want to speak. So make your comments, you know, very precise as you can. And I know everybody seems kind of excited to talk about these things. So it's just in the other comments, and then we need to move to, I guess, the next section. Any other burning comments that you want to really share?
Sí, un comentario que yo tengo que estaba leyendo un día la Biblia en Éxodo cuando iba al pueblo de Israel saliendo a buscar lo que era que iban a durar en el desierto 40 días, pero duraron 40 años por desobediencia. Pero en ese momento se abre el mar y en la Biblia está escrito, creo que es en Éxodo 18, no estoy muy segura, y donde hay un canto que escribe María, la hermana de Moisés, y dice, abrió el mar y con su fuerza ella escribe ese canto, pero a quien le dan el poder es a Moisés. Y siempre como en mi país, que soy de Guatemala, siempre a los hombres les dan como el poder y a las mujeres las hacen como a un lado. Entonces, es algo, ese es mi comentario de que a veces nos hacen como a un lado y el poder lo tiene que tener el hombre.
Yes, thank you for that. For on my side, the connection was a little bit iffy, so I didn't hear the full point. Any other comments? Okay, what I invite you to do is just if you have a piece of paper or something, or you want to write in the chat, just write down your thoughts to share later. You can send it to the organizers of the workshop and we can, you know, pull together those notes. So I don't want you to lose your thoughts, but I think it's important to move on.
Share the slides?
Yes, please.
Next, yeah, there you go.
Okay, so, the first question, how are you already practicing feminism in your personal life? I'll leave it as something for you to think about. We won't discuss it now, but just maybe as we're talking, you can just think and record your notes somewhere on your phone or on a piece of paper. And perhaps next time you're together, you can talk about this. This is a really important question that was already raised by one of you. So how are you already practicing feminism in your personal life? Then the next question has to do with, next slide, please. Right, and this is a collective question, reflection on how you all are already practicing feminism in the interfaith movement. What have you know, just based on our conversation today, maybe some things that you've been paying attention to already, how have you already been thinking about and practicing feminism? And this can just be a brainstorm, your own observation. What are you doing already that's feminist in the ways that we talked about already? So I assume equal pay for equal work. That's something. What else?
I'd love to ask some of you who are staff what you think about this question, or what you've noticed, or what you think we're trying to do.
Elizabeth, is that a new hand that's up, or an old hand?
I think it's our new hand.
New hand, okay, please.
Bueno, ¿cómo estamos ya practicando el feminismo? Bueno, como movimiento interreligioso creo que es bastante abierto. Desde mi experiencia, ¿verdad? Como inmigrante y lo que yo tengo de conocerlo es un movimiento muy carismático.
Danny, excuse me, the sound on your thing is breaking up on the interpretation. I don't know if maybe Gloria seemed to be clear.
Continue,
yes.
Elizabeth.
Yes. That, yeah, it seems Danny's adjusting something. He says okay, one okay. Sec.
¿Puede continuar, Elizabeth?
Okay. Bueno, desde mi experiencia y lo que yo vislumbro dentro del movimiento interreligioso para la integridad humana, es que es un movimiento bastante integral. Siempre tiene puertas abiertas para todo tipo de persona, para toda cultura, toda religión. Y por supuesto, ¿verdad? Un movimiento abierto a lo que es el feminismo, en donde se le dé espacio a la mujer, pero también al hombre. Entonces creo de que es un movimiento bastante actual y siempre está proyectándose con luces hacia la comunidad más vulnerable.
Okay, others, other observations. And as Debbie said, particularly maybe for the staff, what do you notice? Shared power?
Kayla, why don't you say it out loud? Then I'll get interpreted into Spanish.
My comment is around, I see us embodying feminism in the ways that we center the experience of the women who are migrants, the mothers, and the families who have loved ones that are incarcerated. I don't think though we use the language enough. So I'd like to see us be more bold with calling ourselves a feminist organization, similar to how we're leaning into an abolitionist organization.
Great suggestion.
But on top of that, I would like to add that as staff, we also share the leadership of the organization within our regions. And so that I believe it's very, I've been working in nonprofits for a very, very long time. And this is the first place where I get to experience that. And I think it comes from that, feminist vision of really transforming the world.
Lovely, yeah. Elizabeth, is that your hand again or your old hand?
Jose Ruben, were you trying to raise your hand too?
No, ya la había levantado, gracias.
I think so far, you know, I'm having, like I expressed earlier, like I'm really like, I really want to like change like whatever, however I was raised, whatever I was taught as a youth, like basically at any given point have equality, no regardless of their gender, right? like basically, it all starts from the youth. I feel like treating like children equally. You know what I mean, like give them the equal treatment regardless of their gender, right? And I look like to me, looking forward to like, you know, like as my brother, you know, Pedro was speaking, like talking about like you know, having a, you know, basically equal pay for soccer players, right? I look at it like I'm starting to think like maybe like they should have like a, you know, both genders in the same team, you know what I mean? Like sharing the same field, playing for the World Cup, you know what I mean? So, you know, just having that mindset, just like having like just not having that division. I mean, just having just the inclusion of both genders in any profession, you know what I mean? Sport or profession. So that's just basically, this is what's opened my mind up to just that, you know what I mean? So I want to thank all y'all for this. And I just, like I said, I have a mother, I have a sister, I have nieces, and I you know, hopefully one day, you know, I'll get to have a, you know, a daughter of my own, but that's just the way I look at it. And I feel like everything that I was taught as a kid, thinking that just because of the biology is different, I mean, just, you know, there should be like that difference, but in all reality, it's like, it shouldn't, you know? So I want to just, you know, have that mindset towards like equality for everybody. Just how I seek equality, just being an immigrant, it's the same way, just like in any, just as in any gender, like equality for everybody. So thank you.
Thank you for that. Any other comments? The way you are already practicing these feminist principles.
I invite Allison to just say it out loud.
Some of the comments I shared were collective leadership, sharing power, and transformational vision of society that moves far more toward equity for all and inclusion of all. And I too, like Hilda, have been in a variety of other organizations and religious settings that are far less feminist than interfaith movement, and it's a powerful manifestation of the ideals, the way in which they're being lived out.
Okay, we're almost out of time. So, any other last comments? The ways you're already practicing. It sounds like you're doing a lot already. And Gayla's, you know, suggestion was make it more explicit, more direct, call for calling yourselves feminists.
Sounds like Elizabeth says she's not hearing anything. Are others hearing in Spanish? Maria Elena, ¿estás escuchando?
Yes.
Can someone reply to Elizabeth? Just
yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear us? I can hear.
Go ahead.
Yeah, yes. I want to hear you.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Okay, so if somebody could just get in touch with Elizabeth, that would be great. Okay, so let's move to the last slide. And this I'll leave, back, please.
Back?
Oops. Yeah, that one. So this is the last slide. I will leave you to it as kind of a homework, right? So based on the conversation and things you learned today, what could you agree could be the set of feminist principles that you will move forward in your organization, right? The interfaith movement. And so I'll just leave you with this, and maybe there'll be time in another way where you can really consolidate some of the wonderful ideas you had about what it means to be feminist, what it means to practice feminism, and the principles and the values underlying those, and kind of make a little like a declaration or something that you all can get behind to say, yes, we're abolitionist feminist organization, as Gayla suggested. So that's your homework, right? Take what you've learned, take the thoughts, everything you've already known, and make them into a set of guiding principles. It doesn't have to be long. I invite you to do that as a homework. And at some point, show me what you've come up with. I would love to see it. So Debbie, back over to you. Thank you very much for your participation, everyone. And I felt you were really engaged. So, you know, about the World Cup with men and women's team, I'm not sure about that particular idea, but the idea of feminism is to really think big, just like that, right? Mm-hmm. Think of alternatives. So I'll leave here with that and turn it back over to you, Debbie.
I just want to invite us to maybe using the reaction, just give our appreciation for Margot. It sounds like it was a really fruitful conversation for all of us. And thank you for your skillfulness, Margot, in bringing this conversation to us. We're gonna just go with Danny with announcements, important things upcoming, and then I have a closing prayer for us.
Yeah, so just a quick announcement for those who are RSVP for our next Faith Rooted Organizing training. This is gonna be an in-person event starting on Sunday, August 13 and 14. It's going to be from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. It's going to be at the location in Canticle Farm in Oakland. For those of you who have RSVP, I promise to send out some more information about that with logistic and even, you know, folks that you that's going to be contacting you, especially around, like, you know, either transportation or just commuting together. So I'll send all those information out tomorrow. And even folks that are going to be flying in and the places that you guys are going to be staying, you'll get all that information as well. So also understand that some folks are only able to join either one of the day, which is fine as well. So, and even some of your accommodations and your dietary need as well. So you get all those information tomorrow. So with that being, just wanna say thank you so much for joining us this evening. And Professor Margot, thank you so much for gifting us with your time and for sharing, you know, just such rich knowledge of the work that you have been doing. So we just wanna say thank you for that. And with that being, we would like to close with our prayer. Reverend Deb, would you want to pray?
I want to read this, and then I'm going to invite Jennifer to read it in Spanish. It's a surprise invitation for her, but you'll do great. I found this interpretation, this translation of the 23rd Psalm, thinking about God as woman. As a woman, we know that God has no one particular gender, but encompasses, you know, beyond our human thinking about gender. And I invite you to just receive this psalm, this very famous psalm, and see how it speaks to you, especially in the context of the ways we've talked about how religion has, you know, been used to uphold patriarchy in so many ways. I think you might find this refreshing. So we'll do in English and we'll do it in Spanish. So I don't think you need to interpret. The interpreters don't need to interpret. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all I need. She makes me lie down in green meadows beside the still waters. She will lead. She restores my soul. She rights my wrongs. She leads me on a path of good things and fills my heart with songs. Even though I walk through a dark and dreary land, there is nothing that can shake me. She has said she won't forsake me. I'm in her hands. She sets a table before me in the presence of my foes. She anoints my head with oil and my cup overflows. Surely, surely, goodness and kindness will follow me all the days of my life. And I will live in her house forever, forever, and ever. Glory be to our mother and daughter, and to the Holy of Holies, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever, shall be world without end. Amen.
Amen.
And in Espanol.
El Señor es mi pastor. Tengo todo lo que necesito. Ella me hace descansar en verdes praderas, junto a las aguas tranquilas. Ella me guiará. Ella restaurará mi alma. Ella corrige mis males. Ella me guía por un camino de cosas buenas y llena mi corazón de canciones. Aunque camine por una tierra oscura y lúgubre, no hay nada que pueda sacudirme. Ella ha dicho que no me abandonará. Estoy en su mano. Ella puede sacudirme. Perdón. No hay nada que pueda sacudirme. Ella ha dicho que no me abandonará y estoy en su mano. Ella pone una mesa ante mí, en presencia de mis enemigos, y ella unge mi cabeza con aceite y mi copa rebosa. Ciertamente, ciertamente, el bien y la bondad me seguirán todos los días de mi vida, y viviré en su casa para siempre, por los siglos de los siglos. Gloria a nuestra madre e hija y al santo de los santos, como era en el principio y ahora y siempre, por los siglos de los siglos. Amén.
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 Gracias, Jennifer. Y Margo has a question already. She wants us to put in the chat. What are your gut reactions to this version? ¿Cuáles son las reacciones? Thank you for your comments.
And my reaction was, this is not what my grandmother read. And I thought, this can't be right.
Yes. It's so beautiful and like the fullness of God. So have a good night, everyone. Vaya con Dios.
Thank you, guys.
Well, hopefully we'll be seeing you next Sunday.
See some of you all.